Hey everyone, Dr. Jamie here with the Dr. Jamie Show. You are about to listen to content that has the opportunity to increase your success, happiness, and overall likability. Now that sounds like some serious fun, but before we jump into the content, do me a favor, subscribe to the Dr. Jamie Show. Every subscription, every download, every like, every follow keeps this show bringing on amazing guests for you. And now, off to success, happiness, and likability. Hello, and welcome to the Dr. Jamie Show. Yes, this is our final episode, but we have so much more in store with you. For you, the Dr. Jamie Show is all about increasing your happiness, likability, and success, and it is not stopping today. So if you are just tuning in, it is our final episode, but not forever. Actually, we are already live on the audio platforms across all of your favorite podcast apps. So we listened to what you were saying. We jumped on it and you were absolutely right. So ratings have soared. We have sponsorships in line. You know, the video is so great, everybody. So I owe you an explanation. So the video is great. We're going on almost 2 years. So August would be 2 years of live video. However, the top 200 podcasts on iTunes, the top, every single one of the 200 are audio. So after consulting with mentors, people in the industry, hearing what you had to say, you want to take Dr. Jamie on the go. So now you can listen to the Dr. Jamie Show. Ready? 5 days a week. That's right. You get this voice 5 days a week. I really don't know what else you want in life. Your dreams have come true. So the way that it's going to operate moving forward, Monday and Tuesday are going to be episodes that are called bonus episodes. So these are going to be short episodes just to sort of pump you up and keep you going through the week. Wednesday is our big release show. So for example, today's show, we have Semhar Makonnen on, and we are going to chat about all things skin, dermatology. This episode would normally be done via audio and then uploaded for Wednesday, which is our big show. So this show, for example, will go live next Wednesday for you to listen to. So Monday, Tuesday, little bonus shows. Wednesday, our big hour show. Thursday, Friday, shorter bonus episodes. So 5 days a week, 4 bonus episodes, 1 main show every week. Please, 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 more than ever, I need you. So if you can jump on your favorite podcast app right now, subscribe to the Dr. Jamie Show, like us, rate us, review us. Reviewing us is huge. Subscribing to the show is huge. Please take a moment and do that right now. Fabulous. Okay, so that is it. I do have my hat here, which I wore last year. Damien, I don't know if you're watching, but Damien, he is a family law attorney. He wore this hat last Cinco de Mayo. I'm wearing it today. Happy almost Cinco de Mayo. It falls on a Saturday. We are going to have one drunk town, that's for sure. So is drinking bad for your skin? We'll have to find out. I don't, hopefully not for tomorrow. Just tell us no. Tell us it's great. Tell us we should rub the vodka in, like lotion. So we have a great show ahead. So let me give you a little bit, a rundown of what to expect with the upcoming guests. Remember, these will all be audio episodes moving forward after today. So, all right, got my list over here, my cheat sheet. So how to attract the best and brightest client or employees for your open position. That with all businesses across the board, one of the hugest problems we have is hiring. So how can you attract really good people? And we have a recruiter, super successful in the industry for decades, who's gonna chat with us about what you need to know as someone that's in the hiring position. All right, 5 fundamentals to exponential growth with a CEO coach. Pets and CBD oils, that's right, we're gonna talk about it. Can they take these CBD oils? What does it do for them? And then we're gonna have a segment as well on CBD oils specifically for men's health. Women get so much attention when it comes to our health, but what about men's health? So we're gonna chat about that. What else is coming up? Dress codes, what do they mean? This is gonna be a bonus episode. Black tie affair, creative black tie, casual, business casual, cocktail, what the heck? What do you wear? What do these mean? We're going to find out all about those dress codes. myth versus facts when it comes to food. So if you leave out fresh fruit all day, can you eat it? If you leave out yogurt, can you eat it? All those like weird questions. If you take a sandwich to the beach, it has mayonnaise on it, can you eat it 3 hours later? We have a slew, and it's gonna be like a quick 5 minute rundown of like 30 questions. Myth or fact. So that's going to be a really fun episode. Then we have our bigger episode. We have a gentleman on, Jonathan Moore. He's in construction and forensics. He's going to talk about the bridge collapse, but so much more in the sort of construction and forensic type area. Wedding planning must-knows. We just confirmed that this morning. What are the top 5 things you must know when you're wedding planning? And then your horoscope. What is going to go on with your horoscope for the summer? We'll have Marty Montez back on the show, our favorite astrological coach, to chat with us a little bit about what you can expect this summer. Okay, so what do I want to chat with you about? Oh, man, I didn't want this to be depressing, but you've got to know this. We've got to raise awareness. So an episode that is going to go live on Wednesday, this coming up Wednesday, okay, is with a gentleman named Alan Wilkett. He is a corporal for the Pasco County Sheriff's Office. I have something like in my eye, and I think it's the light. Wes, the light, I think it's like, so that's what you get with live shows here, guys. So he taught me something that I didn't know about the dark web and human trafficking, and I want to share it with you just to raise awareness. And explain how we can sort of intervene. So Alan was supposed to be on the show, I would say 2 weeks, three months ago now. He had to cancel because he was called to Washington, D.C. To chat about human trafficking. So we had on a victim of human trafficking. If you remember that episode, remember how, ladies, you'll like die when you hear this. So she comes on to talk about being human trafficked. She was a victim or survivor of it, is a better word. And she goes, wow, this comes full circle for me. And I was like, oh, well, what do you mean? The house across the street, right behind it, was where she was first human trafficked about 30 years ago. So what are the chances? It was just blew me away. So anyway, she told her story, and we had on a couple more guests as well to talk about human trafficking. So Alan was supposed to be here. He got called to DC to deal with something with human trafficking. So I had him on the audio last week, and we're gonna run it next Wednesday. So he talked to us about something that I did not know existed. And I will tell you, this is kind of explicit and really, really bad. So if you wanna like, don't leave the show, but if you wanna hold your ears for a second, that's fine. So there's a new thing out there called organ farming, and it is exactly what it sounds like. So you've got these mean guys that are kidnapping very healthy young women, men, children, and they're locking them in these dungeons and rooms, and they're feeding them and keeping them healthy until someone on the dark web is ready for an organ. At that point, they extract the organ from that live, healthy individual and sell that organ on the dark web. This can be hearts, this can be eyeballs. And so I'm sitting back, pretty much when you hear the audio, I'm speechless. I don't know what to say because I didn't know that existed. How can I make a difference? What can I do? I don't wanna go to a site and donate $100. Like, what is that gonna do? So educating people, I think, is a great way to spread the word. So it's all about stopping the buyer, and that's where we're gonna start shifting our attention in society. It's no more taking the bad guy and say, you extracted an organ from this guy, you're going to jail. Well, he will go to jail. It's more so finding these people that want to buy these humans or buy these parts and get them in even like bigger trouble. Because if we can take the buyer out of the picture, there's no one to sell these people or these organs, I can't believe I'm saying that, to somebody. So anything that we can do to raise awareness to stop these buyers, I know I want to be a part of and spread the word. So let me know how, and I hope that you can spread the word as well. There's also branding where they take the humans and they tattoo them to brand them and say that they are mine, which is just so amazing to me that our society does this. I have a Dr. Jamie Show episode. If you go to YouTube, type in Jamie Kulaga, The Dark Web, and it gives you ways to stay safe on the dark web. We know so little as these good people on the outside about the dark web, but there's some really horrific things that happen back there. So if you can take a part in, you know, making some kind of stance to stay safe on the dark web, to stand up and raise awareness for people without a voice, I guess give a voice to the voiceless, that's what we need to do as a nation, as a society, as a world. So be a part of that. So I didn't want to be a Debbie Downer today, but I did think it's important to sort of share that with you so that you can find ways to give a voice to the voiceless. So that episode is pretty intense and it will be airing on Wednesday. So the following Wednesday, we will have a fun and upbeat segment with Semhar Makonnen. She is here and she is going to chat with us about what you've been waiting for. Can we pop those pimples? What kind of SPF do I have to use? And wait till you see her hair. It's pretty damn awesome. Come on out. I love it. Yeah, welcome. Take a seat.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I'm so glad that you're here today. We are going to have a fun day. I know that you guys are sponsors of the show. I can't wait to use your service. I'm using her service next week, just so everyone knows. Everyone is going to have to check out what they offer at Academic Alliance in Dermatology. They have great people, and we are going to have a ton of fun today. So we're going to put some of that negativity I just talked about aside, right? We go from organ farming to, hey, let's put on SPF. But it's important to raise awareness. And with skin, we're going to chat about raising awareness, what we can do to be healthier, and probably to make our kids healthier too, right?
Absolutely.
So, okay, so before we begin the show, the guest always has the same first question. What is something unique or bizarre about you that very few or no people know about you?
Something unique or bizarre about me?
Yes.
Okay, so I speak 3 different languages.
Oh, wow.
And so sometimes, not sometimes, all the time, I count in different languages because I think it's more real. In different languages. I dream in different languages.
Which
wow. Is weird.
Oh my gosh, I can't imagine like tonight dreaming in like Spanish.
Yes.
What languages do you speak?
Oh, I speak Ethiopian language. It's called Amharic.
Okay.
And I speak Tigrinya. It's Eritrean language and English.
Okay, so can you say in one of the languages, watch Dr. Jamie or listen to Dr. Jamie on the new audio show? Can you?
I gotta think. Okay, yes. Vaka tun Dr. Jamie radio show Adam too.
Ah, yay! I love it. I love it. That's amazing. That's excellent. Yay! Okay, so now I want people to kind of know who you are. So before you talk to us about your profession and where you work, are you married? Do you have pets? Do you like long walks on the beach? Tell us a little bit about who you are.
So I was born and raised in Ethiopia. It's a country in the Horn of Africa.
Okay.
Moved to the States about 17 years ago. I've been in Florida for about 17 years. I live in downtown St. Petersburg. I love St. Pete. I love the vibe.
Yes.
Love running by the water. I like the Saturday morning market. I buy all my groceries there. I like to support local farmers.
Nice.
I love to travel in my spare time.
What's the favorite place you've ever been?
I've traveled to 30 different countries, into counting.
Wow.
So most favorite place I've been to would be Kenya. I went on a safari tour. It was amazing.
A bucket lister for many.
Absolutely, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
It's been my biggest teachers in life. I love just going into new cultures, new adventures, trying out new food, and meeting new people.
Nice. I love it. So we'll take our first family vacation sometime this summer out of the country to Italy.
Absolutely.
So have you been to Italy?
I have passed through it. No.
So, wow, you've been everywhere. Oh, so if you want to come with us, you're welcome. Oh my gosh,
yes.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So what brought you here from your country?
The American dream.
Yes. Yeah.
I wanted to go to school here and be somebody.
Yep. And now you are. Yep. Now you are. I love it. And now you're super famous. You're on the Dr. Jamie show. That's right. This is where all the famous people go. Okay. So I guess now, how did life lead you to being in this specific field? Kind of what happened?
So dermatology has always been sort of intriguing to me. I remember I was a child, I was 6 or 7 years old, and I got some sort of a fungus infection on my scalp, and my hair started falling off, and I lost most of my hair.
We cannot lose any of that pretty hair. No.
It was very traumatizing. Yeah. And kids were making fun of me, and it was very hurtful. Yeah. And they took me to different specialists, and nobody could figure out what it was. And finally, somebody figured it out, and I got treated. But it left such an impact in my my young age, I guess. Yeah. And I thought it was so cool that somebody helped me out, mm-hmm. and I wanted to be in that position one day. Mm-hmm. And I worked in pediatrics for a long time, and then opportunity presented itself to work in academic alliance in dermatology, and I jumped on it, and I'm very happy I did.
Yay! Excellent. Fabulous. Okay. All right. So dermatology. Okay. So a dermatologist, dermatology, what exactly is this?
So dermatology is a branch of medicine, and it focuses on hair, skin, and nails, and diseases associated with it.
Oh, okay. So it's more than just, like, so many people think it's just like the skin, so it's hair and nails too.
Absolutely.
Oh, good. I'm going to need you to work on this. This is good to know. Put me down for another appointment. okay, all right, very good. So are there different forms of dermatology?
Yes. So Academic Alliance in Dermatology has different branches of dermatology that it encompasses. So we do our most work medical and surgical dermatology. So that involves in identifying skin cancers and treating them surgically. Mm-hmm. And there's also pediatric dermatology where we see a lot of kids. Okay. There's also a research aspect of things where we focus on different dermatological disorders and diseases associated with them, and we do research on those.
What would
as
be
well.
Like an example, and this is just kind of off the cuff, but like a dermatological.
So we do a lot of psoriasis, research, and even acne.
Okay.
There's multiple different researches that we conduct at the same time of dermatology targeted research. There's also, there's also dermatopathology, mm-hmm. is where we send our biopsies and where they study them and find out if there's cancer in your biopsy or not. There's also Mohs micrographic surgery, which is the most tissue-sparing surgery.
Okay.
So those are usually done on the aesthetically sensitive areas, so faces would be that.
So the Mohs, I saw that and I was like, what exactly is that? So for the people out there, what is that?
Mohs is it's a most tissue sparing surgery.
Okay.
So if you have a skin cancer and it happened to be on your face, your ear, so it's aesthetically sensitive area, we recommend the type of surgery, Mohs surgery.
Okay.
And Dr. Mohs is the one that kind of created the surgery. And we take your tissue, the cancer area, we sample it and we send it to our lab. And while you're in the waiting area, waiting 45 minutes or so, mm-hmm. they study those tissues and actually see if there's still cancer in there.
Wow.
And they'll tell us, oh, there's still some cancer left in there. You have to go back, and we bring the patient back in and take more tissue. So it spares tissue.
Well, am I hearing this right? It's on the spot. So you're not taking it and then they're waiting 6 weeks for results.
No, it's on the spot.
That's amazing.
Yes. That's cool.
That takes away so much anxiety for
absolutely.
Someone.
So before you leave the office, you know you're all clear.
Okay.
And we suture them up, and then that's it.
Okay.
We're done.
And I can hear people out there saying, okay, you said surgery, so do I have to be sedated? Are you taking a scalpel? Some people are freaking out.
It's lidocaine, local anesthesia, so you do not have to be sedated for this.
Excellent.
It's an office procedure.
Nice.
So yeah, oftentimes it takes a couple of hours of your day.
Okay.
And you're done.
And you could save your life.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, I love it. So yeah, definitely worth it. Now, if anyone out there has any of those spots where you're like, I've been wanting to get that check, now you know it's pretty painless and could save your life and
absolutely.
45 minutes of time to wait for your results.
Yeah. So those are great options for people that have cancers in the face, the ears, or aesthetically sensitive areas of the body.
What division at Academic Alliance in Dermatology do you work in?
I work in, we have 17 different offices in Tampa Bay area. And I work in Clearwater and Countryside locations. So that's Clearwater on off of Myrtle, and Countryside would be on McMullen Booth.
Okay, so if you want great attention, those are the offices you for sure have to go to. We were talking before the show that, and this is the thing, you've got to find someone reputable whenever you want, you know, touching with your skin. We were gonna talk about Botox later on, things like that. We were talking before the show that somewhere in, what was it, Columbia? Was it Columbia was? Okay, Columbia, where they're having like these home parties, and you've got these smugglers smuggling in, I guess, what appears to be like concrete, and they're injecting it into you. So, yeah, get out of your house if you want this done, and go to Academic Alliance. They have no syringes with concrete in them. I can promise you that. So I want to get to the meat of the questions now. Let's chat skin cancers first, especially being here in Florida. Now, keep in mind, we do have a very diverse audience across the country, but we do have a chunk here in Florida and a nice chunk in California as well. What are the most common types of skin cancer?
So when we talk about skin cancer, there's melanoma and non-melanoma type of skin cancer. So their major groups are those two.
Okay. They're both cancerous.
Skin cancer. So melanoma is a malignant type of skin cancer. Okay. It's the deadliest form of skin cancer.
Okay.
And then there's non-melanoma type of skin cancers, and the major ones are basal cell and squamous cell cancers.
Okay.
Depending on what type of skin cancer you have, and the treatment will vary based on that. So basal cell skin cancer is the most common type of skin cancer. About 80% of skin cancers are basal cell.
Okay.
It likes the most sun-exposed areas of the body, so we see it a lot on the face, the scalp, the chest, the arms. Mm-hmm. It appears pearly, pinkish, red, blistering kind of lesions that don't go away.
Okay.
And those are basal cell cancers, and we biopsy them, and if you catch them early, they're 100% curable.
Okay.
Very easy to treat.
So one time, let's say someone goes to you, they get this off, does this kind of cancer come back?
So the cancer itself does not come back, but having a history of skin cancer puts you at a higher risk of developing multiple other cancers. So you may have a basal cell here, but you're more likely to develop another basal here. Another basal.
So you really got to keep a check on your...
Absolutely.
Okay. Yes. So how, and I know we're just going off for a second, but so in that case, how often should someone come and see a dermatologist?
So on average, everybody should be checked by a dermatologist once a year.
Okay.
If you have a history of cancer, then that puts you at a higher risk. So based on your type of skin cancer, you have basal cells, squamous cells, we recommend at least 2 to 3 times a year.
Okay.
And melanoma will be a lot more frequent than that.
Okay. Okay. So now there's the other kind, which is the melanoma.
Melanoma is the most aggressive type of skin cancer, and it has the potential to invade internal organs. It has the chance to metastasize, and we see it a lot. It goes through the pancreas, the lungs, and the even the brain. So it's the most aggressive form of skin cancer. And by the way, May is Melanoma Awareness Month.
Oh, yay! Yes. I planned that just so you know.
So yes, melanoma is scary. So definitely go through your ABCs. It's an imperfect synonym to kind of remember, but it is something for people if they're worried about their moles. Go through your ABC. So A is for asymmetric. So if you were to fold the mole in half, is it asymmetric? Does it fit the other half?
Is that good or bad?
It's bad.
Okay.
So it's kind of a red flag.
Okay.
So go anything that has border irregularities, it's a red flag. More than one color in a mole is another red flag. Look at the diameter of the mole. Is it greater than 6 millimeter or a pencil eraser?
Okay.
Size of pencil eraser. Those are some identifiers. Or a mole that's evolving, changing. So rapid changes within a month or two.
Okay.
That's another red flag.
So let's say you looked right here. Oh my God, Jamie, that's definitely melanoma. Can you just take this off and I'm done? Or it's already in my body?
So once we identify a skin cancer and we assume it's melanoma, we take a biopsy of it.
Okay.
The biopsy is the initial step.
Okay.
That tells us how aggressive that melanoma is.
Okay.
For the most part, the melanomas we've seen in our community, people are very advocate and very good about coming and getting their skin checked. They're the type that are melanoma in situ. So those are, that means they're confined in a place, they haven't traveled or metastasized anywhere.
Okay.
They're simple to treat and they're curable. The melanomas that are out in the community that have been sitting there for a long time that go down and invade and travel through the lymph nodes, they tend to metastasize.
Okay.
But the initial step, taking the biopsy, will tell you the degree of the melanoma. Is it just confined? Has it metastasized? Has it invaded other organs? That will be your initial step.
Wow, okay. And so is it, I guess, myth or fact? So like people in Florida are gonna be more prone because we have more of the sun here? Or is it like the redheads or the blue eyes or the blonde hairs?
It's a little bit of both.
Okay.
So genetics plays a big role in melanoma. So study your family history. Knowing if your parents or your siblings have had a history of melanoma, that puts you at a higher risk for getting melanoma because genes, they matter.
Mm-hmm.
Also, being fair-skinned off the top, that puts you at a higher risk. Light hair, light eyes, red hair, freckly people, having moles, more than 50 moles in a patient, that puts you at a higher risk.
50?
50 plus moles.
Wow.
That puts you at a higher risk for
melanoma.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh my goodness. Fall off. Wow. Yeah, well, it's funny I asked that because my son, so we all have brown eyes. My son has blue eyes, thanks to the mailman. Just kidding. But he gets, when he goes on the boat, I can douse him in sunscreen, but his eyes like almost turn like you can see through his body. There's like, they go so light and he gets like the reddest of everybody. So, and that's with sunscreen and a hat and put sunglasses on, and it's amazing.
Absolutely.
What a difference.
You have to be diligent.
Mm-hmm.
Skin type that burns easy are a higher risk versus skin type that just tans.
Okay.
So blistering sunburns at a childhood is a higher risk for later on getting skin cancers.
Okay. Wow. Okay. I went off the cuff like 100 times with her. So, all right. So for everyone out there that now is officially naked in front of the mirror looking at their body during the show, and they're pointing to everything, what should we not worry about on our body?
So worry is a big word. I say be proactive about things. So things that are not worrisome are the little red dots that we see, the blood blisters. They're harmless, they're hereditary, they're called angiomas.
Okay.
Or
I have a question in here about that. What the hell are they? Like, where are they coming from?
You tend to get them as we age, and if your parents have them, you tend to get them. They're harmless, they may be aesthetically unpleasing, and you can get rid of them very easy. It's an office procedure.
Okay.
Yeah, we can numb them and just take them off.
Take them off, bam. we shouldn't worry about those. Is there anything else that's common that we shouldn't worry about?
Skin tags are something that we see a lot. They're not cancerous. Although I have them checked by a dermatologist to make sure they're really skin tags, but most of the time those are not.
Where the hell do those come from? How do you not have a skin tag and then one day it's there?
They like friction and rubbing. So they like places where there's a lot of friction. That's why they like the neck and the armpit areas.
Gotcha. These little bastards, man. All right. Acne. What is it? And what the heck causes it?
So our sebaceous gland produces sebum, and we have bacteria that lives on our skin, and it causes inflammation, and we get those cystic acne, basically.
Okay, so for all of, and this is probably my next question, I think, for all of the 13 to 18-year-olds out there that are listening, that are like, please save my life, I'm dying, is there any hope for them, or did hormones win this one?
Yes. Those are teenage acnes are driven by hormones going through teenage years. And they also, if parents have had acnes most likely the child will get acne as well.
Okay.
There's plenty of therapies out there. There's a lot of topical medication from Retin-A to topical antibiotics that you can try. Topical medications take longer to work,
okay.
But if you have mild form of acne, then they're a great option.
Okay.
If they're a little bit more aggressive, moderate to severe acne, there are oral medications out there, oral antibiotic that we can put patients on, and also Accutane or isotretinoin, which is one of the best medications and the most effective ones as far as acne goes.
Okay, so for the teenager out there that's like, my mom won't take me to a dermatologist and help me with this, is there anything else I can do? So are there things that teenagers do that maybe, hey, stop eating that or stop washing your face with that? Is there any other tips?
Actually, using acne-based washes,
okay.
It helps. So benzoyl peroxide,
okay.
Or salicylic acid are,
okay.
Acne-based washes, and you can purchase those anywhere over the counter and,
okay.
Use them, wash your face, and stay away from
touching it
multiple times.
Yes, and it is. It's such that touch zone, too.
Absolutely.
For whatever reason. Okay, adult acne. So now I know the adults out there are like, oh my God, this is terrible. I thought this was going to go away when I turned 19. But it's still there.
Absolutely.
Hope.
There's hope.
Okay.
So we like to find out what's causing the acne first, and that helps us direct our therapy based on what's causing it.
Okay.
A lot of adult acne could be from stress. It could be environmental factor. It could be things we're doing to ourselves. And there's plenty of options out there if you want to just do topical medications. Again, Retin-A is a great medicine to put on for topical adult acne.
Mm-hmm.
Also, if it's hormone-driven, they respond well with birth controls or oral antibiotics. And again, isotretinoin is one of the most effective treatments as well.
Okay, so is that the chemical? Is that like the chemical that's in these? Like, because I know I've known people that watch all these like ads on TV,
mm-hmm.
Proactive, and you know, all these other ones. You know, buy them now, and they're gonna make your face. You can see like the most beautiful model with like perfect skin. He's like, oh my God. When we take a bottle and we flip it over, is there something? So that we know, is Proactive really good? Is this really good? How do we know?
So most of those Proactive, those over-the-counter medications are good. They
mm-hmm.
To a degree, they work.
Okay.
But if none of that stuff is working, then you need medical grade.
Okay.
So you need a prescription strength.
Gotcha.
So yes,
okay.
That's the big difference.
Okay.
Proactive and medicated acne medications.
Okay. Fabulous. Excellent. Okay. So what should we wash our face with? Mom used to say, Grandma used to say, go get a washcloth, go get the bar of Dove soap, and you're going to be good for life. Was Grandma wrong?
So depends on the type of skin you have. Some people have dry skin, some people have oily skin, some people are a mix. So kind of know what type of skin you have, so you can see a dermatologist and kind of seek that to
okay.
Get the right and the most definitive answer.
Okay.
But general rule of thumb, just use a gentle wash.
Okay.
No scrubs to actually wash your face.
Okay.
Fragrance-free, comedone-free washes are best.
Okay.
If you tend to be oily or acne-based skin, then use the benzoyl peroxide type of washes. That would help dry out the acne.
Okay, so I use two things. I use a Mia, and I use Cetaphil. Cetaphil, am I
yeah,
saying that right?
That's
good,
great
bad?
Product, yes.
Okay, good.
A gentle product.
Okay,
a good. Product.
Yeah, I actually read the back. I don't know if anyone that has uses the Cetaphil and read the back of the bottle, it actually says you can leave it on and not wash it off. I don't know if I could ever do that. Like, how awkward would it be to like wash your face and leave the soap on? But interesting fact, if you didn't know. If you read the bottles of things, you'll find out. Okay, so it's good.
Good.
And the Mia's okay?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Very good. Okay. One thing we all don't know about skin.
One fact we don't. Oh. So skin is the largest organ in the body.
I did not know that. I would have said like the heart. The bone is the femur, right?
I heard that.
You heard that? You did?
Wesley,
so you believe her?
Wesley told me.
Oh, Wesley, our 11-year-old, apparently. Who knows more than his mama? Okay, all right. So the skin, the biggest organ in the body.
Yes.
All right. Viewer question here. So this one has to be answered awesomely. Okay. I am going through menopause. I'm not feeling pretty. Yes, I am confident. Yes, I dress up. Yes, I wear makeup. Yes, I have a great job, but I'm still feeling old. I don't really want a facelift or those intense procedures. Is there anything I can do naturally? Intense facials, something for wrinkles, etc. Please help.
Oh, of course, there's plenty of things you can do.
Okay.
So most people forget this, but our skin is part of our body. Now, people exercise and they eat healthy, they eat green vegetables and fruits and take vitamins to take care of your body. Yep. And you can do the same thing to take care of your skin.
Okay.
Nourish your skin. Drink plenty of water, use moisturizers, use plenty of sunscreen, because the sun is the most damaging factor for our skin. And of course, you can do some peels to kind of get rid of the dead skin on the surface of our skin.
Okay.
So you can do some chemical peels that will help.
Are there different levels of chemical peels?
Absolutely.
Okay. But
depending on the type of skin you have, there's different. You can be very aggressive and do a TCE peel, and there's also mild and gentler peels.
Okay.
And just get rid of the dead skin that's on the surface so that the new skin can
revive. Yeah,
absolutely. And there's non-invasive procedures, plenty of them, in our aesthetic dermatology department that we do, and that would help rejuvenate your skin. There's Botox and fillers. Okay. They're considered non-invasive and they're safe and effective therapies as well.
Okay, excellent. So there is hope. You can feel gorgeous. You can join me because I'm going to go to Academic Alliance in Dermatology like in the next like couple days. Not even kidding. So come join me, the viewer with that question, and we'll have a great time there and we'll be taken care of for sure. Okay, so actually I want to ask my Botox question since we just brought that up. And I don't know where it is, but I remember it. Oh, here it is. Botox, good or bad?
It's great.
Okay.
It's safe. It's a neurotoxin agent. You can use it anywhere. It's approved for facial wrinkles.
Okay.
It's very effective.
Okay.
It gives you that smooth kind of look.
Okay.
And it lasts for about 3 months, and it's pretty immediate. You see the effects of it within a week.
Okay. So some people say, and I'm totally open to this, so I just want to know. Some people say, well, it's bad. It's putting poison in your body. Is it putting poison into your body?
Well, going out in the sun,
yep,
and exposing your sun,
okay,
causes you to have sun damage,
okay,
and cancer. That's poison in a sense.
Yes.
Eating plenty of cheeseburger is,
okay,
essentially causes you to have a heart,
okay,
disease.
And
so,
this is approved though, right? This
absolutely
is approved.
Botox has been alive for about 30 years. Women have been using it more than that.
Okay, and I know, and this is just something I don't know too much research about it, but you can actually use Botox to help with migraines. So that was amazing.
I actually used it on patients.
Have you?
For migraine purposes.
Amazing,
yes.
Amazing. And some people, that's so devastating, those migraines, anything to take it away.
Absolutely.
Would be. Okay, all right, sunscreen. 4, 6, 8, 30, 60, 80, 100. This is what I see when I go to Target. I also see a lot of other cool things that end up in my shopping cart. However, when I'm in the sunscreen aisle, I see all these numbers, I see all these brands. My mind is so confused. 100 seems better than 6. 60 seems better than 40. What is SPF and what do all these numbers mean? And is 100 where we have to go?
Absolutely no.
Okay.
Okay, so SPF means sun protective factor. And American Academy of Dermatology,
okay,
recommends an SPF use of 30 plus,
okay,
for sun protection.
Okay.
So you do not need 100, you don't need 7, absolutely.
Okay.
You need 30 plus to get the full effect,
okay,
of sun protection.
Okay.
You need to have sun physical block, a sun physical blocking agent. Now, those ingredients may include titanium dioxide,
mm-hmm,
or zinc oxide. Those are the two physical blocks.
Okay.
When you purchase a sunscreen, make sure it says broad spectrum, mm-hmm, on it. That means it protects you against UVA and UVB rays.
Ah, that's what that broad spectrum means. Now I love it. Excellent. Because we see all these words and we're like, oh yeah, SPF. But like, what does it really mean? What does it really do? Okay, so 30 plus. Now, is that the same for kids? So is adults 30 plus and kids are 50 plus or 30 plus?
You need a minimum of 30 plus.
Okay.
And what most people forget is reapply.
Okay.
And most, they're not supposed to label the sunscreen agent saying that waterproof or water resistance because it's misleading.
Okay.
So reapply if you're going out in the sun and the water every 2 hours minimum of reapply and cover. And you need at least an ounce of sunscreen to all the sun exposed areas.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I actually use, for me I find, and I don't know if this is worse or better or the same, but there's the sprays and then there's the creams. But try to get a cream on a kid. That doesn't happen. So come here, and then you're, get back here. So, and then the sand gets all chunked up in it, and then they're crying, and your beach day is ruined, and you come home. So we do the spray, but I do feel like with the spray, I get better coverage all over. And a tip for parents out there, spray the scalp.
Absolutely.
Oh my God, you forget that. You forget. Especially, you know, girls with longer hair, you gotta get that whole scalp.
Absolutely. You get a lot of sun.
Yes, directly beating right on your head. So, is there SPF for your hair, or can you put SPF on your hair? I'm always in, like, the salt water, and so I'm like, I think it's important. So I've been trying to wear a hat lately, but, you know, that I think that the sun will kill it. It's just pounding.
Protective clothing.
Yes.
Wear your long sleeves, your hats, and your sunglasses.
Yeah. I'm the worst. I'm dreading this appointment next Tuesday. They are going to yell at me. So, okay. How bad is tanning oil? No SPF.
Tanning oil in itself is not so bad.
Okay.
Most tanning oils, believe it or not, have some SPF, 7 or 6.
Okay.
Not sufficient enough.
I've seen
it
2.
It has a little bit of sun protection in it. You can use tanning oils, tanning lotion, tanning sprays are okay as long as you apply your sunscreen.
Okay.
SPF 30 plus.
Okay.
What is not okay is tanning beds are not okay.
Okay.
They are a known fact. They cause skin damage and skin cancer.
Wow. Okay. So I will admit I did the tanning bed in like my early 20s, like 1920. So, and then I was like, I want to save mine. It was like $7 at the time. I'm like, I want to save my $7, you know, like, you know, back in the day, I'm like, do I overdraft the account or do I get to the tanning bed? Like which one? Okay. So bad for you. Now there are some places out there that say, no, we have good lights. We have good lights. No. Okay.
No tanning beds.
No tanning beds. So tanning bed is a no. What about spray tans?
It is okay.
That is okay.
Spray tans.
Freckles. What are they? And are we okay?
You are okay.
We're okay.
So we are not born with them.
Okay.
So it's a result of sun damage.
Really?
Yes. So the melanocyte in your skin respond by sending in those freckles. So you go out in the sun, you get more freckles.
Yes.
It is a result of sun damage.
Oh, so now I can't lie. No. Yeah, so, okay, that's so funny because my son has had freckles since he was little. Hasn't Blake had freckles, like, right here for, like, forever? But I guess it's just the sun.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Very good. Is there, this isn't off the cuff, so if you don't have an answer, it's fine. Myth or fact, lemon juice takes freckles away?
No. Myth? Not to my knowledge. No.
So I remember being in like middle school or high school and girlfriends were over with a lot of freckles. I actually am okay with my freckles because I don't have like crazy. But they would like, you got to put lemon juice on them. They'll go away, and they would dump lemon juice on their face. So No, you can drink lemon juice, but don't put it on your face. Okay,
no.
So there's no trick with that. You know, feel free if you're watching this show to chat in with like your most famous, like, this never worked, but I did it to my skin anyway. I'd love to hear some of your funny things you did. Okay, the red skin dots, we talked about them. Yeah. They're not dangerous. We're okay.
All right.
What are some ways that we damage our skin that we don't even know that we're doing?
So some ways we damage our skin, just tanning bed use.
Okay.
Definitely, that's very damaging to the skin. Going outside in the sun, the sun is the strongest between the hours of 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. Okay. So just a rule of thumb to remember, if your shadow appears to be shorter than you, that means there's a stronger of the sun rays.
Oh!
So avoid that.
How fun! That's a great little tip.
Little things that we do for our skin that we don't even know we're doing.
Yeah. So anything eating? Is there any foods we should stay away from? Should we drink a lot of water?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Hydrate. Majority of our body, we're made out of fluids and water, mm-hmm. so definitely drink lots of water.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I saw this thing, I don't know, a couple years ago, of this guy or girl who did like, I don't know if it was like a YouTube or a split screen, and he drank, oh no, it was like 30 photos. He drank like a gallon of water a day for 30 days, and every day he documented a picture of his face, and by the 30th day he looked like a just refreshed
wow.
man completely. You could probably search that on the internet. Okay, yeah, so water, I think absolutely. Okay, random dark spots are showing up on my skin. They are not cancer. Why did this happen, and how do you treat these spots?
So there's age spots that we get due to just being alive and in the sun for so long, sunspots or melasma is another one of those stubborn things to treat. Basic treatment would be stay away from the sun because it really loves the sun, it loves heat. There's plenty of treatments that we can do. It could be on the surface of the skin, the epidermis, or it could be in the dermis, which is a little bit deeper layer of the skin. Depending on where your dark spot is or your melasma is, there's treatments out there. But you would need to somehow peel the skin off initially using a chemical peel and then use a lightening agent. So like a hydroquinone kind of medication. A combination of those treatments are usually very effective.
Okay.
But it will come back if you're going to be outside in the sun a lot. So just protect your skin from the sun after you get the treatment.
Okay, on this question, it says, we talk a little bit about hyperpigmentation. What is that so people know, and then what's the treatment for it?
So hyperpigmentation is what, melasma is another term for it.
Okay.
And some women tend to get it, and it has a lot to do with your hormones, or medication can cause that too.
Okay.
People that have a lot of yellowness to their skin type get this melasma and hyperpigmentation. It's stubborn, it's not easy to treat, and it's usually on the face, so women are very self-conscious about that. There's treatment out there, it works. You just have to be diligent about applying the lightening cream and using it in combination with a peeling agent.
Okay.
And then there's also laser. You can also do laser treatments, and it's very effective.
Going back to the peels for a second, how often should someone get a peel? So like for the woman that was saying, I feel older right now, how often do you get a chemical peeler?
There's different grades of chemical peels. If it's for the look of it, you can do it every couple of months, three months spaced out. We also use it to treat precancer, so that's for treating, getting rid of the precancer cells so you don't actually develop and get a full-blown cancer.
Oh, interesting.
So yes, it's used for both ways.
Nice, I love it. Okay, warts, where do they come from and are they bad?
Warts, they're viruses. They're a form of HPV virus, human
papillomavirus. Oh, wow.
Yes, they're out in the community.
Okay.
So when we become adults, most of the time our body can just fight it off. It's just a virus. And most kids get them because of immature immune system. There's plenty of ways to treat them. You can do home remedies. There's over-the-counter medication. Usually they come back. They're stubborn.
Mm-hmm.
You may need multiple treatments to get rid of them. But in the office, we have cryotherapy where we freeze them.
Mm-hmm.
We can treat them that way. There's also EDMC where we scrape and kind of burn them, mm-hmm. and also you can always cut them out. And there's also an antigen that you can inject, and it's almost like a vaccine to wake up your own immune system and fight the wart off.
Interesting.
So there's plenty of ways to treat them. They're a nuisance, and a lot of kids get them, and they multiply because they're viruses. So
all right, another
share them to other people.
Yeah, I know. And okay, so another off the cuff, true or false? I heard this in kindergarten, kind of thing. If a frog pees on you, you'll get a wart.
That's a new one. I've never heard of that. No,
okay, good. You know how far up until this day I have stayed away from frogs? I'm like, even if they jump around, like, I'm not having that thing pee on me. I am not getting a wart. So, okay, good to know that these little frogs that I've been like, okay, good. All right, so you cannot. So good news for us kindergarteners out there. If a frog pees on you, you will not get a wart. Skin tags, we talked about them. Okay, what are some simple skin must do's and don't do's to have good skin, nails, hair?
Simple, we kind of talked about it. Simple must do's: do wear your sunscreen diligently. Okay. Check your moles, check your skin, and have a dermatologist check your skin and your moles to make sure they're normal.
Okay.
And also be diligent about getting your skin checks.
Okay.
Hydrate your skin,
okay.
Wear sunscreen, and avoid the sun between the hours of 10 and 4, if
okay.
you can help it.
What about it's biotin, right? I'm thinking that's the biotin people tell me to take. And they're like, it's like a hair, nails,
it works.
So it's good.
It helps, yes, for the hair growth, nails.
Any other vitamins that we have to take out there that you're like, this will help?
For the face, okay. it's excellent vitamin E and A,
okay.
Fluoric acid, those are great things. It nourishes the skin.
Yes, vitamin E. My mom used to always take vitamin E growing up. I remember that. Always take vitamin E. Okay, so since we have a couple minutes left, before I ask you the last question, a little bit about where we can learn more about you, you got some products here today.
Yes.
All right, tell us a little bit about them. What do we need to know? What must we have, etc.?
So this is one of my favorite products. It's a sunscreen. A lot of women like it.
Okay.
it really matches with your.
It's a brand new bottle. It's a brand new bottle. It's gonna
your skin tone.
We see it.
It matches with your skin color.
Let's see. Wait. I get it. There we go. Oh yeah, nice.
It's so nice and gentle, and has SPF 50, and it has all the physical blocks you need. So these are the benefits of getting medical grade skin sunscreens.
Okay, so we're gonna turn this into an audio. So this is Even Up Clinical Pigment Perfector, right? So broad spectrum SPF 50 sunscreen. So this is great for the face. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. What else do we have?
Love it. We have a great toner and a foaming gel. Those are great to kind of use them in combination. They're travel sizes. You can see they're amazing.
So is this for washing your face?
After you wash your face, you can put it on as a toner.
Okay.
So it kind of helps even out the skin.
Okay, fabulous.
This is another sun shield. It's SPF 50. It's really, really great. Goes easy on the skin.
Okay.
And it has SPF 50. And has
okay.
physical
and this
blocks.
Is... This is for body or face?
You can use it for body or
okay,
face.
Okay, nice. So Sun Shield Broad Spectrum SPF 50. How do you say this name?
Obagi.
Obagi, okay.
It's a medical grade
okay.
sunscreen, so it works very well.
Okay, so
you can't buy it over the counter.
Can we, if, cool. for people that might be out of state, like if we go to your website, is there a way to buy this through you, or you have to be in Florida to purchase this from you? Florida? We'll have to...
It's available everywhere.
It's available everywhere? Okay.
Any right. dermatology office
okay.
actually
okay.
would have it.
Okay. What are these?
These are for the lips. It's made by Color Science, and it has SPF 35.
Oh, nice. So do we need to protect our lips?
Absolutely. It's part of your skin.
Okay.
So it definitely needs to be protected.
Okay. Yeah. Does it also do this so that your lips are just dump it on
a little bit. This one is, I actually use it. It's one of my favorite ones. Ladies love this. It's a little powder, and you apply apply it and reapply it. It matches your skin tone.
Nice, and it's not makeup, so if guys want to use it.
Oh, they can use it, okay. Actually, yes.
Question? You need it.
Yeah.
We'll let you use that one. Yeah.
It's wonderful. It's one of my favorite ones, and it doesn't feel greasy or oily in your skin. You just apply it, and then you go about it.
Nice. It's important for guys too. Make sure that you're protecting your skin. So often, like I said earlier, you know, so often we talk about, you know, just health for women and your skin and hair and nails. You think women just pops into your head, but guys, you need to take all these tips. You need to heed all this advice. So important.
Absolutely.
So
yes.
Important. Okay. All right. So before we end today, where can everyone go to find more information about you and Academic Alliance in Dermatology?
Okay, Academic Alliance Dermatology, you can go on our website,
okay.
www.tampadermatology.com.
Nice.
And that would lead you right to our website. You can see all the different services we provide and the different offices that we have. 17 locations throughout Tampa Bay, and it's been in business for about 30 years.
Yay!
Yes, and or you can go on the Facebook and follow us on Instagram as well.
Nice.
Social media.
Excellent. Thank you so much
Thank
for joining
so
us.
Much.
I love it. I will never go out in the sun without sunscreen again. I will put a hat on. I'm going to take biotin. And if a frog crosses me, I know I will not get a wart. You've eased a lot of my anxieties about frogs. Everyone, have a wonderful Friday. Thank you for joining us on the final Dr. Jamie Show episode in person. We are all audio now. So go to the app on your phone that you listen to podcasts, type in the Dr. Jamie Show. We are there. All your favorite episodes are there. And we have a slew of shows coming up. Remember, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, bonus shorter episodes. And Wednesday, you'll get the longer shows. So Dr. Jamie, 5 days a week, all on audio. Subscribe, like, download, and rate us now. Thank you for all of your support through this 2-year journey so far. Adios. Thank you so much for listening to the Dr. Jamie Show audio experience. I really hope that you enjoyed the tips and advice given on today's segment. Do me a favor and go to iTunes and my YouTube and please subscribe to that channel. Every subscribe, every like, every follow helps the Dr. Jamie Show grow so that we can bring you the best guest and the best content possible. And of course, as always, if you have any feedback, feel free to leave that as well. Talk to you soon.